these nutrients are necessary for you to have a healthy life and to improve the quality of your body's functioning. And the way I like to explain it is that just like we drive a car and we think, oh, we just put gas in our car and it'll go. There's all sorts of other things that you have to maintain on your car to make it go and have really good functioning, right? So you got to put air in the tires and make sure you have water in the radiator, oil change, things like that. It's the same thing. You could eat whatever you wanted without much thought, but if you're not getting all your nutrients in, potentially there could be some problem in your body down the line. So nutrients do different things. Some of them give calories, some of them do building materials. They may help repair or help improve your health. I'm just putting my timer on here so I know how much time I have. And they'll support growth, especially for when we're young and growing. So the six nutrients that we're going to talk about are water, vitamins, minerals, carbohydrates, proteins, and fat. Hold on one second. Let me look at my chat box down here. Okay. So the first one we're going to talk about are carbohydrates. Carbohydrates have a lot of bad rap lately in the press and the media, makes people not want to eat them. But I would encourage you that carbohydrates are a nice and a good thing for your body to that it needs, because carbohydrates provide fuel for the body. They can be broken down into two different groups. One is starches and the other one is sugars. So starches are larger molecules or compounds, where sugars are small and individual. When we talk about which carbohydrates are good for people to consume, the better choices are always going to be your whole grain or your less processed carbohydrates. So what we're talking about is anything that when you're reading the label, which we're going to talk about shortly, is looking for unprocessed grains. So it'll say like whole wheat or whole grain oats, something like that. You really want to limit refined grains and added sugars. So refined grains just means that the outside of that seed has been removed. And this outside covering is known as the bran. And within that bran is where all the fiber is. And the fiber is what your body really needs as well. Also attached in there is something called the germ, which is a nice little fatty oil pocket that gives the seeds some growing potential as well. And those are good for humans as well. So I grew up in the 70s. So my mom was a big wheat germ lady. And so we grew up eating a lot of wheat germ, and you can still get it. And it's a powerhouse and a good thing to consume as well. The reason we're not really encouraging people to consume sugar, and so what that is added sugar, and it's just not sugar, but it's also things like corn syrup or high fructose corn syrup, is because these things are considered an empty calorie. What that means is it gives your body energy, but it doesn't give you any of the vitamins, it doesn't give you minerals, antioxidants, or phytochemicals. Why should you eat these whole grain carbohydrates, such as whole grains and legumes, fruits, and vegetables? Is because of fiber. And I know Dr. Sinha likes to talk about the bacteria that live in your GI tract, but fiber is what those bugs that live in your GI tract are going to feed off of. If you're not consuming enough fiber in your diet, those bacteria aren't going to survive. And then you're not going to get all the health benefits that those bacteria can give you. There's a couple different fibers that we can eat from these high fiber carbohydrates. There's soluble fiber and insoluble fiber. And they do, some of the things they do or their roles are similar, and some of them are very different. Generally, what fibers can do is help keep you full. They can help reduce your blood cholesterol. And that, because of that, it can decrease your risk of cardiovascular disease. There's been a lot of studies about the reduction of certain types of cancers, particularly colon cancer. And now, wait, I'm going to move this so I can see the bottom here. And the goal for fiber is about 25 to 38 grams per day. So I always like to ask, if we're supposed to be eating about 25 to 35 grams of fiber per day. How much do you think that the average person eats in a day? Anyone? Anyone? Oh, that's a good one. 5 to 10. Anybody think higher or lower? You're a little low, but or right, well, the 10, it's usually about 10 to 12 is what they, the people, when they do epidemiological kind of questioning of the average American. So Americans eat about half of that. And the reason behind that is a lot of Americans don't eat enough fruits and vegetables. These are your proteins. Proteins do a lot in our body. Most people, if asked, what do proteins do? They would think, oh, it makes muscle, right? And that's what the structure and the movement, right? So protein is important in muscle and ligaments and tendons, which help us move. But it also does so many things. So it creates enzymes and hormones that help us digest and utilize our food. It creates communication proteins. So different parts of our bodies can talk to each other, transport proteins like hemoglobin. It also, proteins create antibodies, which help keep us healthy. They help with fluid and electrolyte maintenance and acid-base balance. When we talk about proteins, proteins can be found both in plant and animal sources, right? So you can see some of the pictures up in the left there, you know, so most people, if asked, like, where do you get protein? They would say, oh, chicken or beef, right? Well, so will eggs, but you can also get it in nuts and beans, lentils, soy are also good sources as well. So how much do you need per day? Well, and the data shows it's about 0.8 grams per kilo of body weight for a healthy adult person. If you don't know how much you weigh in kilos, it's roughly about half your weight in pounds, okay? The typical American diet, people easily eat meat. This need, because the typical American diet is also very high in protein. So if you don't know, like, oh, am I getting enough protein? Roughly an ounce of meat, so it could be poultry, meat, turkey, whatever, fish, cheese, one egg, one cup of milk, all have about 7 grams of protein, okay? So if you eat a 4 ounce piece of chicken, it'd be 7 times 4, 28 grams of protein, okay? In terms of plant-based, you can see tofu is pretty protein-packed. If you ate a cup of tofu, you get about 20 grams of protein. Half a cup of beans or lentils is about 8 grams, half a cup of quinoa, grams, things like that. Let me just check my chat here. Is protein from powders okay? Protein powders is fine, is part of your diet. You know, I always encourage people to try also to eat food-based protein in their diet as well, because there's so many other nutrients that are associated with food-based protein. But for those people who have difficulty eating these protein foods because of chewing and swallowing problems, then yeah, adding protein powders would be a way to help meet your needs. If you're able to eat and you have a good appetite, you're likely meeting your needs without the protein powder. Fats is the third type of what we call macronutrients. So carbohydrate, protein, and fat are the macronutrients because we need them in bigger amounts. They're organic compounds. They don't dissolve in water. Most of the fats that are in our body and that we consume in our diet are called triglycerides. You can, once again, just like carbohydrates right now are considered like the bad food. I can remember back when I was in graduate school, fats were the bad food and people were like, don't eat fat. You know, fat is bad for you. But in reality, fat is a necessary component of your diet. For a lot of people that I speak to that have difficulty with poor appetite, fat is a great way to help you meet your calorie needs, because it's what we call a calorically dense kind of nutrient. It has 9 calories per gram, where protein and carbohydrates only have 4 calories per gram. There, just like there's good choices and better choices in carbohydrates, there's good choices and better choices in fats. So your healthier fat kind of choices include those poly and monounsaturated fats because these types of fat have had less impact on your heart and general wellness. So that would be anything that's a liquid oil, meaning it's liquid at room temperature and you can pour it. Anything like nuts and seeds or anything made from those. So nuts, trail mix, nut butters, seeds, chia seeds, flax seeds, sesame seeds, poppy seeds, whatever you like, olives, avocado, cold water fish. So you get your omega-3 fatty acids. Those fats that aren't as good for you are those, they're called saturated fats and also trans fats. So saturated fats are naturally occurring. And they come from those meats that have more solid fat, visible fat when you look at them. Typically red meat, so things like beef, are going to be a much higher source of saturated fat than say chicken or turkey, especially if you're removing the skin from the chicken and the turkey. The trans fats are chemically in the laboratory. And what happens is those oils, those liquid oils, have hydrogen added to them. And then the molecular configuration changes and they become trans fats. The food industry loves trans fats because trans fats are extremely shelf stable and can sit for a long period of time without going bad. The problem is we've recognized, especially in the last like 10 years, is that trans fats are extremely problematic in your cardiovascular disease, your cardiovascular system. The other thing is trans fats also have been shown to be pro-inflammatory. And so anything that makes inflammation in your body is not necessarily a good thing as well. So how do you get rid of the trans fats? One way is to eat less processed food. So, and learn to identify the trans fats when you're reading a label. And so you look for this word here, this hydrogenated. And usually you'll see it as hydrogenated soybean oil or partially hydrogenated cottonseed oil, something like that. And if you see that, then you know that there's some trans fats in that food that you're consuming. The thing to remember too, and we're going to talk about label reading in a couple of minutes, is that if a food has less than half a gram of trans fat, so if it has 0.49 grams of trans fat per serving, they can put a banner on the label saying that it's trans fat free, even though it does have trans fat. So reading the ingredient list is always a great way for you, the consumer, to be more savvy about what's in the foods that you're eating. We also see a lot of these saturated fats and trans fats in fast foods and processed foods. And so why is the American diet so rich in these saturated fats and trans fats? Well, the typical American diet is rich in saturated fat and trans fat because the typical American consumes a lot of fast food and a lot of processed food. And so I'm going to be speaking a lot more about processed foods and what they are at the patient caregiver symposium in April. But basically a processed food is something when you go to the market and you can buy something that comes in a box and you add water to it and it becomes a meal, something like that. And that's because the food industry uses those saturated fats and those trans fats so that box of whatever, biscuit mix, can sit on the shelf for months without going bad. Let's see. What about brands like Huel, which makes plant-based proteins in a convenient form? You know what? I'm not quite sure what Huel is. So I would have to, if it's something like a plant-based, like meat substitute, those kind of things can be helpful and be part of a diet. But what I would encourage you to do as well is to read through the ingredient list and look for preservatives and chemicals and additives as well, because sometimes those kind of foods contain a lot more additives that if you're trying to avoid them, they may not be the best choice. Let's see, my Trader Joe's basmati brown rice has 0.5 gram of saturated fat versus the white basmati, which has zero fat, but isn't white processed, which to choose. You know what? And that's weird that it has the 0.5 grams of saturated fat. I'd have to look at the label myself, just kind of look at it. I'm trying to think through like food science, the food science part of my brain is coming into play here. The only thing I can think of is that it potentially has that germ still in there, which would be the fat. In my mind though, I wouldn't think that it would be saturated. So as long as there's nothing, if you read the ingredient list on that brown rice and it's just brown rice and that's all that's in the box, then I would say that's probably still the better choice. Vitamins are organic compounds that are vital to life. They're indispensable to body functions and you only need them in a tiny amount. So there's a lot of confusion with people when we talk about vitamins and do I need to take a supplement and all that kind of stuff. And this could be a whole topic of discussion for future meetings. But what I'm going to tell you is most of the studies that are done on vitamins and diet is all done looking at food sources of that vitamin. And so, but what people do is they go, oh, I heard that potassium is good for my blood pressure. And so instead of trying to eat more potassium rich foods, what people do is go and try to take a potassium supplement instead. But what you have to understand is all this data that's accumulated is done from people who are consuming vitamin rich food sources, not taking supplements. So you can't extrapolate that data and assume that you're going to get the same results from taking a supplement. One of the reasons that you hear dietitians always talking about how important it is for you to eat fruits and vegetables is that plants have the ability to make vitamins, right? Plants don't consume anything. They're just growing out in the earth. They're sucking up the minerals from the ground. They get the sunlight, they get some water. And internally in their leaves, they can create their own vitamins so that they can grow and survive and thrive. We as human beings don't have that capability. So we need to consume plant-based foods in order to get these vitamins that our bodies need. The other reason that I would encourage you to consume vitamin-rich foods over taking supplements is that supplements are not regulated in the United States. So unfortunately, if you're just buying them off the internet from a place that you really don't know anything about, you don't really know what's in that vitamin that you're getting. The other thing I would encourage you to think about is that vitamin supplements don't cure anything except a deficiency that you may have from a vitamin. And the only way you're really going to know if you have a deficiency of a vitamin is by doing some sort of blood test to determine if you have a deficient level. Going online and looking at symptoms and then just taking mega doses or very large quantities of vitamins isn't going to cure anything. It's not going to give you more energy. Because vitamins don't give you any energy. They don't have any calories. And I already said that, so let's go on. Minerals are another micronutrient. They're non-organic. They don't contain carbon. And minerals, you think more about your structure of your body. So they're important in your bones, in your teeth, muscle contraction, relaxation, blood pressure, fluid status. And minerals, the same thing. It's always recommended that you get it from food sources rather than supplements. And in both cases, vitamins and minerals, unless you're suggested by the doctor to take one because they've done some sort of laboratory work, it's not recommended that you take large quantities of vitamins. It's something to always talk to your doctor about, especially if you're undergoing any kind of treatment. And that way they can also look at your medications that you're on and making sure that you're not going to get any kind of interactions. If you are told to take a vitamin by your physician, one of the things that I always recommend is that you look for one of these kind of symbols on the vitamins that you take. This USP, what that means is that the company that's making that nutrient supplement has actually paid this lab to analyze their supplement. And so that you know what you're taking is actually in that supplement. Same thing with consumer labs. Okay, so these, and so if you're buying it, say at like Costco, and you're buying Nature Made, I think it's one of the brands there, they probably have this USP kind of symbol on there, because that's a large vitamin company that's pretty reputable. So the last of the nutrients is water. If you don't know what water, why water is important, there's a lot of things there. People always want to know, how much water should I drink? It's kind of there's no like blanket amount that everybody needs to be drinking, because we all have different needs. And especially if you have other kind of medical conditions, large quantities of water may not necessarily be good for you as well. Generally speaking, most people need somewhere between, I would say, 6 to 8 cups of fluid a day. The other thing to remember is, if you're eating more fruits and vegetables, those also count as a source of water, because many of them are, you know, 80 to 90% water. The goal is always to prevent dehydration, making sure that you're getting enough water. The other thing, I put in a little thing here too, is there's no need for special types of water. So a lot of people ask me about alkaline water or oxygenated water and all that kind of thing. And what I would tell you is, buy the type of, if you're going to buy water, buy the type of water that tastes best to you. But there's no magical quality associated with alkaline water or high oxygen water or anything like that. People always want to know too about tap water, and depending on where you live, you know, it can be fine for you to consume. And you can always contact your local municipality, and they can give you a water report, and that it'll tell you what the contaminants and things like that are. So what are the healthiest diets out there? One of the top diet picks that comes up every year is the Mediterranean diet. So what is the Mediterranean diet? Here's the old food pyramid there. The reason this is a top pick is that by doing epidemiological research on populations that follow this type of diet, what they found is that they have very low rates of cardiovascular disease, lower rates of cancer, improved longevity, so people are living longer. And the basis of this diet is whole grains, legumes, nuts, seeds, olive oil, fish, seafood. Okay. You can see the bottom 2/3 of that. There's smaller amounts of poultry, dairy, and eggs, and very limited amounts of red meat, added sugars, refined grains, things like that. When I look at this, and why does it work? It's because of all these, the high amounts of fruits and vegetables they're consuming, as well as these low saturated fat types of meat. But you can also see in here, you know, there's no Doritos in here, there's no Flaming Hot Cheetos, that kind of thing. So is it what they're eating, or is it what they're not eating? In America, this is one of the big things that I use, is My Plate, when people don't really understand about how to eat healthy. Because I like to use this, because you can teach a 5-year-old how to do My Plate. It doesn't require, you know, a high degree of literacy or understanding. The focus in My Plate type of eating is making half your plate fruits and vegetables. Unfortunately, in the United States, how people choose their plate, I'm not going to call it My Plate, but their plate, is generally half their plate is grain and half their plate is meat. So if you think about it, what does that mean? That means they're eating steak and potato, they're eating chicken and rice. And in reality, they should be having steak, a little piece of steak, a little bit of rice, a big amount of strawberries, and a big serving of broccoli, something like that. So half their plate is fruits and vegetables. And what's that? What that's doing is focusing more emphasis on the plant-based aspects of the diet. So you're getting more fiber, you're getting more of those nutrients, and then it's forcing people to consume less protein. And by cutting back on their protein, what that's doing is causing a reduction in saturated fat intake, and that's improving somebody's cardiovascular health as well. The other thing that's good about MyPlate is it kind of causes portion control, which means people, if they're trying to lose weight, are eating less. The other nice thing about MyPlate is it works well with if you follow ethnic food choices, or if you're a vegetarian, MyPlate is a good way to do it too. When we talk about there's five aspects of a healthy diet, they include adequacy, variety, moderation, calorie control, and balance. And for me, I think what's really important is this focus on moderation. And people are always asking me like, oh, is it okay if I eat this? Or is it okay if I eat that? And what I think is important is that you understand this concept of moderation. So what we're telling you is, it's not that you can never, ever eat something. And let me think of what I could do. Okay, let's just say fried chicken. It's not that I'm saying, I never will tell somebody you can never eat fried chicken again, because I think that's setting unrealistic expectations, especially if somebody loves fried chicken, right? But what I would tell somebody is fried chicken isn't the healthiest option. So maybe you could have chicken prepared, I don't know, grilled this way. But if you want to have fried chicken once a month, I think it's okay to have chicken, fried chicken once a month, as long as the majority of the time you're not consuming fried chicken. So what moderation means is some foods you're limiting your intake of, but when you do have them, you enjoy them, they're delicious, and then the next day you're not consuming fried chicken again. So I think moderation is an important concept that we should focus more on. And that kind of also it's not having us put foods in either good buckets and bad buckets. It's like all foods can fit in a healthy diet. It's, we just all need to be practicing moderation. For some of us, there's those foods we just love and we want to eat all the time, right? So for me, it's ice cream. I love ice cream. I could eat ice cream every day. So for me, I don't have it in my house, because if I have ice cream in my house, I cannot practice moderation because I can hear it calling me from my freezer. So it doesn't matter. It could be 11 o'clock at night and my eyes could open and I can hear the ice cream calling me. And then I have to go downstairs and have ice cream. So for me to practice moderation, I don't have it in my house. And if I really want ice cream, then I go out to an ice cream shop. You know, like I splurge and I go to Salt and Straw and I have a really good cup of ice cream. And I enjoy it, and then I'm done. But I try not to bring it in my house. The other thing is variety too, is just getting a wide variety or selection of foods in your diet, especially when we're talking about fruits and vegetables. So I just loved this picture, this eat your fruits and vegetables, this rainbow of colors. And it's recommended that you consume a minimum of 2.5 cups of fruits and vegetables a day. And some people will be like, I don't like fruit or I don't like vegetables. That's fine. Then I'm not forcing you to eat what you don't like. Then you would just eat 2.5 cups of whatever you would prefer. And the reason we encourage so much fruit and vegetables is also not just the fiber, not just the vitamins that they contain, but they also contain these other nutrients. Wait, I'm really going to cough, so I'm going to mute myself for a second. They also contain these things called phytochemicals and antioxidants, which are also called phytonutrients. And each color provides various different health benefits. And no color is superior to one another. So back when we first started talking about the rainbow of fruits and vegetables, a lot of dietitians were like, avoid the white. There's no color in white. It's not good for you. But in reality, things like onions and garlic, cauliflower, parsnips are all white, but they all have nutritional value as well. So white's part of the rainbow in this case. why are these so important? Because they reduce oxidative damage to cells. They can stimulate your immune system. They can repair DNA damage. They help regulate hormones. So these phytonutrients are so, so important. Let's see what time it is. I'm going to skip through the next couple ones really quick. These are just the different types of phytonutrients in each of the colors. So here's your red. Lycopene is a really popular one. Orange and yellow. It's cryptoxanthin. Greens have like the isocyanates and the indoles, the blue and purple, the anthocyanins, and white and brown. Here's your allicin, and it has an anti-tumor. So always including a wide variety of all your different fruits and vegetables is so, so important. The other thing I always tell people too is if you're not a big fruit and vegetable person, sometimes it's you've always tried to eat them cooked. Maybe it's trying to eat them raw might be helpful. Some people just need to try different types of toppings. So maybe adding lemon juice or a vinegar if you like that kind of thing. Maybe some fresh ground Parmesan cheese on top may help things taste a little better. Dips like hummus or ranch, but try different ways of eating them. The other thing too, sometimes it's fun to try different fruits and vegetables that you've never seen. And you might be surprised. Oh, that tastes pretty good. Oh my gosh, wait. Frozen dessert store. It's about 6 cents round trip. It's plant-based, no dairy, and very delicious. Is it yogurt, Pamela Ellis? Because if it's yogurt, I have been there and I agree. Oh my gosh, it is so delicious. Yes, Pamela Ellis, I 100% concur. If you've never tried yogurt, it's delicious. And that is one of the other places that if I need my ice cream, that's where I'm going. I saw this on Instagram, so I kind of stole it. So don't tell Claire Chunin, but I'm giving her credit. If you can't pronounce all the ingredients on an ingredient list, it's probably because you're not a chemist, not because necessarily the ingredients are toxic. So our foods have a lot of different things in them. So reading through the food labels is always really a good thing for people to do. So I just want to do a little quick thing about food labels. By law, the label has to contain a number of different things, of course. But let's talk mostly about this. So this is your nutrition facts, which will tell you a couple things like how many servings per container in there, what is the serving size, which I think is always important, how many calories are in one serving, and then the nutrition facts associated with it, like fat, cholesterol, sodium, carbohydrate, here's your fiber. What I love about the new label is it also has to include 10 grams, give the amount of added sugars. I think it's important here for you all to understand that this is not naturally occurring sugars, like in milk, that there's naturally occurring sugars, or fruit, there's gonna be naturally occurring sugars. This is sugars that the food company has added into this food product that you're consuming, okay? This percent daily value gives a lot of consumers some confusion, but what you need to understand about the percent daily values are only used on the food label, okay? And it's what they are is basically a tool for you, the consumer, to compare food products. It also, based on what this value is, will tell you if it's a good or high source of a nutrient. So you can look over here to the left. A good source will have 10 to 19% of the daily value per serving. If something has over 20% or more of the daily value, then we could say that it's high in that nutrient. So in this case, like total fat, there's 10%. Would we say that this food is a good source of fat? Sometimes some nutrients like fat you may not want to have high amounts, right? What you want to look down here is like vitamin D. So this would be high or a good source of vitamin D. It's high in calcium. It's high in iron. So these are really important to look at. The other thing too is, like, you can see this product had 20% of the daily value for added sugar. So potentially this is not necessarily a really good thing, especially if you're trying to consume less sugar in your diet. Some other words that you may see on your label are things like less or fewer or reduced. And that means that there's 25% less of a nutrient or calories than a reference food. Light means a third fewer calories or half the fat of a standard food. We've got a couple questions. Let's see. Please explain the fat info. There's only eight grams, but only 1 gram explained. Okay, Lloyd, hold on a second. That's because so when we look at total fat, it's going to be a couple things. There's going to be saturated fat, polyunsaturated fat, monounsaturated fat, but on the label, legally, they only have to give you total fat, saturated fat, and trans fat. So when I look at this, there's 0 grams of trans, there's 1 gram of saturated. That means the 7 remaining are likely from monounsaturated or polyunsaturated oils. Does that make sense? So some labels, though, this is like what they have to tell you. Some nutrition facts are a lot longer because the food company decided to give you more information. So say something has a really high amount of monounsaturated fats, and consumers know that monounsaturated fats are those heart healthy kind of oils. So they're looking for that on a label. They may choose to, under total fat, you might see monounsaturated fat and that amount of that. But labels don't have to give you the monos. They only have to give you saturated and trans, if that makes sense. Okay. So the next one, we're going to compare a couple cereals. So there's the Cheerios box and the Lucky Charms. Now, the reason I chose this one is just because if you look down here, or if you look up here on the Lucky Charms, there's this nice banner that says whole grain. Well, and you're like, well, Amy just said whole grains are good. So maybe Lucky Charms is something I should be eating, right? Not necessarily, because what the food company is going to do is be like, oh, we're going to use that. And people will think that Lucky Charms is a good product. The Cheerios over here, you can see they have a big banner too, whole grain guaranteed. They do have this heart-shaped bowl, love your heart so you can do what you love. And in this small writing down here, it's talking about how eating Cheerios can be part of a heart healthy diet. And they can make that claim, that health claim, because consumption of oat bran has been shown to reduce your risk of cardiovascular disease. Why do I have these is just because I want you to look through the ingredient list. So let's start with Lucky Charms. Yeah, it starts with whole grain oats, which makes you think, okay, it is whole grain, so that's good. But look at what that second ingredient is. It's sugar. That's those added sugars. So is this really the best choice for you to consume? Probably not, being that, because when we're looking at ingredient lists, it's listed in descending order by weight. So when you see sugar listed as the second ingredient, it's not a good thing. Oat flour, there's another corn syrup. That's another source of added sugar. Modified cornstarch, dextrose is a scientific word that means, guess what? Sugar, salt, gelatin, trisodium phosphate, yellow 5-6, red 40, blue 1, and other colors. So all of that is colors and dyes. There's natural and artificial flavor. And then you can see all the vitamins that they've added in to make parents feel better about feeding their kids Lucky Charms. Let's look over here on Cheerios. You can see that it includes whole grain oats, including the oat bran. So that's that high fiber, soluble fiber that's good for your heart. Modified cornstarch, a binder. Sugar is third. salt, trisodium or tripotassium phosphate, wheat starch, vitamin E, and then the vitamins. So you can see here, a lot less ingredients, a lot less colors. There's no artificial flavors, artificial colors. So that's probably a little bit better choice. Oop, another question, hold on. Can you suggest that is not legally required? Yes, I can get you some sort of reference to talk about what can and cannot be put on a label. Let's see. I just wanted to tuck in here. This is a little bit about, this is National Nutrition Month. It started March 1st. The logo for this year is Fuel for the Future. And it's how to provide fuel for the earth and people's future. So I just want to talk a little bit about sustainability when you're meal planning. Here we go again. Amy is always like, prioritize plants in your diet. And this is when people are talking about a plant-based diet, a lot of people think what health providers are talking about is a vegan diet. But in reality, really what a plant-based diet means is that plants are the basis of your diet, but it isn't saying that you do not include meat. So a plant-based diet is just one that has a lot of plants in it, but you're not necessarily foregoing meat. A sustainable diet also minimizes meat, but especially beef, because in order to produce a pound of meat, it requires something, you know, like 100 pounds of grain, that kind of thing. And the water and the energy and everything to create that meat is not sustainable in the long run, especially as population continues to increase. What happens though is a lot of times when people start to consume a plant-based diet, they continue to eat meat in their diet, but instead of maybe having 8 ounces of meat at a meal, maybe it's gone down to 2 ounces at a meal. So that 8 ounces maybe is feeding the whole family as opposed to just feeding one person. The other thing too is we talk a lot about making fish more option in your diet, but it's also important to select your fish choices carefully, not only because we hear a lot about mercury toxicity and things like that, but a lot of fish species are being overfished and are becoming extinct. So it's important to make those kind of choices carefully. There's a great list on Monterey Bay Aquarium Seafood Watch's website where you can look up what fishes are becoming extinct and how to make good choices. One of the things I like to do is go to my local farmer's market and buy local, their local produce or their local eggs. Not only are you supporting local and likely organic farmers, but you're getting a really tasty plants and other foods there. And it's kind of fun to walk around and try different things. It's important to eat mindfully and buy mindfully to reduce food waste. Something like a third of the food that's produced in the world is not utilized and has to be thrown away on an annual basis. Decrease the intake of your ultra-processed foods, which are we'll talk about more at the symposium. But ultra-processed foods take a lot of resources just in the production, so a lot of fuel. But then those ultra-processed foods are packed and then shipped, and the shipment of those foods also takes a lot of resources as well. I always encourage and all of my like students and my patients to always buy in season. And so when you're buying produce in season, you're getting a better quality product and you're also likely buying local. And the other thing is to compost. So any of your waste, your fruit and vegetable waste, making a little compost bin where you're creating fertilizer that then you can put on your trees and your plants in your yard is a great way to utilize that food waste as well. And you're creating your own little microbiome, which is kind of fun as well. I was just going to finish up with a couple of facts or fictions if you guys want to do that. Otherwise, we can open it up for questions. But I'll just start and we'll see how it goes. So wait, I gotta move this. Eating certain food combinations can be unhealthy. True or false? So should you eat where you're combining certain foods and avoiding certain food combinations? Anyone have a thought? All right, well, I'm gonna go on. And that is false. So a lot of people are told they shouldn't eat certain things like fruit with meat or something like that. There's a lot of rules about this, and it's really not sustainable for most people's lifestyles. The other thing is research supporting its health benefits are limited at best. So when they've tried to put people on either food combining diets and non-combining diets, basically both groups have the same outcome. Instead, really what's best to do is eat a balanced combination of nutrient-rich foods at every meal. And in reality, sometimes eating certain food combinations together is really good. So like combining a vitamin C-rich food with an iron-rich food can actually increase the absorption of iron. Or eating a high carbohydrate food with a protein food, like eating fruit with your Greek yogurt, can actually slow down the digestion and release of sugar into your bloodstream. And I think one of the biggest things to understand why this doesn't really play out from a science perspective is that when we're talking about carbohydrates, proteins, and fats, our body has different enzymes, which are these little molecules that basically cause reactions to occur. And you have specific enzymes that are specific to carbohydrates, that are specific to proteins and specific to fats. And so by eating, what the premise behind this is, when you eat them together, those that there's not enough enzymes to go around. Well, there's different enzymes associated with each of the food groups. The other thing is there's digestion of each of those macronutrients at different parts of your GI tract as well. So eating them together doesn't overwhelm your GI tract. All right. How about this one? Eating after 8 makes you gain weight. Has anybody heard of this? Oops. False. Yep, you were correct. So that's false. So what makes you gain weight? It's when you're eating more calories than your body's utilizing or burning. So what really matters is how much you're eating, what kind of calories you're eating. And I always encourage people to think, like, what are you usually doing after 8 o'clock at night? Most people are sitting on the couch watching TV, right? So when you're sitting like these little kids are in front of the TV eating, most of the time what you're doing is you're focused on TV and you're really not keeping an eye on how much you're eating. So they call that mindless eating. The other thing to remember is when you're hungry and you want a snack, if you're trying to keep an eye on your weight and not gain weight, a snack is really only about 100 to 200 calories. But most of us, when we sit down to eat a snack, are eating closer to 300, 400, 500 calories. So, all right. Fresh fruits and vegetables are more nutritious than frozen. True or false? Anyone? Oh, let's see. It depends. That's a good answer. Yeah. But in general, what I would tell you is this is false. So the thing is, frozen produce, if it's just like, I'm going to say it, like frozen green beans or frozen corn, not broccoli with cheese sauce frozen, it can be actually more nutritious than fresh, because oftentimes fresh produce is packed or picked when it's not quite ripe. And then it's sent off to a room where it's hung out there until it needs to come to the store. So sometimes by the time you're getting that fresh produce at the grocery store, it was picked, 2 weeks ago. Frozen produce is often picked and then processed within hours of being picked. So you're getting ripe product that is, cleaned and cut up and flash frozen really quickly. There can be some nutrient differences, but the differences are small. But the big thing I always tell people when they ask me, like, is it okay if I buy frozen produce? I always ask, like, what works into your, one, your budget, two, your lifestyle. So if you're somebody who lives alone and you find that when you buy fresh produce, you end up throwing, you know, half of it away, is that really doing you much good? Probably not. So sometimes buying the frozen stuff where you can open it, take out what you need, reseal it up, put it back in the freezer and have that, you know, 2 or 3 days and you're never wasting it. I always have frozen produce in my freezer because that way when I'm meal prepping, you know, and I'm like, oh, I need a vegetable. Oh, I don't have any fresh vegetables. Oh, I got some frozen stuff. I'll use that. Or if I'm making soups, it's really easy to use frozen produce in your soups and get more vegetables in. And that's the other thing too. When I'm making like a soup or a stew or a crock pot dish, I always put way more vegetables in than the recipe calls for. And that way my family gets more vegetables and they don't know it. Ha, ha, ha. We'll talk more about canned products. And that's the other thing too. Like I have a lot of students who are on really limited budgets. And I'm like, if canned is all that you can afford, I would say eating canned is better than not having any produce. If you're gonna buy canned vegetables and fruit, I would say try to always buy the lower sodium ones. When you open them, rinse them to get rid of some of that salt. And if you're buying canned fruit, always get the one that's packed in water or juice, not the heavy syrup. Okay. Yep, exactly. And that's why, Carol, too, I was like, it's always best, like if you're going to buy produce and you have access to a farmer's market, that's the same thing. They picked it either that morning or yesterday and you're getting it right away. And you're also getting the stuff that's in season. All right, should you detox your body regularly? True or false? False. Exactly. You guys know. Oop. Yeah, so we have organs in our body, the liver, the kidneys, our lungs and other organs work round the clock to get rid of anything, any waste from metabolism. And unfortunately, when they ask these detox companies to name a single toxin that their products eliminated, they couldn't even name one. So I think what's important to help detox, if you're thinking about that, is eating lots of fruits and vegetables, getting all that fiber in, having regular bowel movements, making sure you're drinking a lot of water. I think that's really the way to detox. And of course, have a moderate intake of those foods that aren't necessarily the best for you. Is it ever useful? So I'm going to say there's certain religions that maybe would use a fast, which is a type of detox, as part of the religious culture. Which could be useful, but I don't know if necessarily from a medical detox might be if you, or maybe using a lot of drugs or something might be a good thing.